Just about a generation or two back, life was totally different. When our education system was made for a certain thing, you cannot imagine how different life was. Children used to mostly be in what we call as joint families, 5 people, 10 people in a house. Just outside the house, there were clusters. There were people living in neighboring houses where children could go in and out. Children watched animals, children watched human beings, children watched nature. They had everything informal and they had to create things. Take a simple thing like games. There were no organized playgrounds and these and that. There probably one fellow would either get a bat, or if no bats were available for cricket, he would ask one of his uncles who knows carpentry to, you know, chop off one piece of wood and make it into a bat and give. Somebody would get a ball and they would find some playground. They would go to that playground and they would start playing, and somebody would come and shout at them saying that don't play over here, and they would shoo them off. While they are there, the fellow who got the bat would say that I want batting because it's my bat, and then they would have a fight over it and they would argue and they would come to some conclusions. All these things, how to handle these situations, were what we refer to as life skills. Children learned from morning to evening everything to do with how to deal in a better situation in life. Within the last one generation, last 2-3 decades, what has happened is that all the children, all the families and all have got confined into now what we refer to as 2 BHK, 3 BHK, 4 BHK type of things. So now what has happened is that many of us, from adults to children, are being deprived of a certain learning. What is that learning? We refer it to it as life skills. That means the skills to lead an enriched, a happy and a fulfilling life. It is regardless of whether the person is educated or uneducated, whether the person is young or old, whether the person is rich or poor, all that is secondary. We live one day at a time. So today I am alive. I am living this life. I get up in the morning. I interact with my family members, I plan out for the day, I do a lot of things, then I move on to what has to be done for the rest of the day. I face certain challenges, certain things make me happy, certain things make me unhappy. I have to deal with all those things till the end of the day. At the end of the day, when I go to sleep, I may be happy, I may be unhappy, I may sleep very soundly, or I may toss and turn with, you know, a lot of worries about what happened today or what is likely to happen tomorrow. That's how the whole thing, you know, goes. Now, what we need to understand is that as it is, there is a great need for us to learn life skills as an additional input, because the regular inputs that were there, that village life or locality life, even in cities, for example, children had all the freedom to roam around wherever you want. 10, 20, 30 years back, even in a city, everybody in the locality knew each other. Children could walk in and out of each other's houses. They could even go to a shop and take something on credit saying, you know, Appa will come and pay you later, and that shopkeeper would pat him and say, okay, take it and go. That's the type of life. Children used to walk to school running around, kicking stones, you know, plucking some fruits or leaves from plants. All that used to happen. Each one of them is a life skill learning by itself. It teaches you a lot of things. Anyway, what happened, as I said, in the last one generation, what happened is lifestyle changed completely. We locked ourselves much before all these words like lockdown and all that were heard. We ourselves had voluntarily locked ourselves down. We were living in what, you know, Desmond Morris refers to as the human zoo. We created these cages for ourselves where we limited ourselves to 800 square feet, 2000 square feet, whatever it is. And then we thought life is going to go on. No, it doesn't. The same thing happened to the education system. More and more of competition, more and more of portions, more and more of testing, more and more of competitive exams. All this are a product of this last one generation. When I wanted to get into IIT, there was a very simple test which was done, no coaching, nothing. Whatever we had learned in the 12th standard, we just went and reproduced that the thing, and then somebody got admission, somebody didn't get admission. It was fine. Those who didn't get admission, there were also so many other engineering colleges, they could go there based on their 12th standard marks. They got admission. They also became very competent engineers. Many of them overtook the IIT guys eventually. All that was happening. Now today, with all this competition, these, that, and limitations and all that, things were pretty bad. For the last 20 years at least, I have been constantly reminding people that please pay attention to life skills. And while lifestyles deprived us of learning life skills naturally, we were lucky enough to get inputs starting from Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences to Daniel Goleman's emotional intelligence to World Health Organization, a reputed body of the United Nations. World Health Organization came out with the 10 basic life skills. This was in the 90s, more than 20 years back. From that time onwards, we started holding seminars, we started talking to educators, parents, people saying that please give significance to life skills, teach life skills, learn life skills. Even as an adult, it doesn't mean that just because you are 20 or 40 or 60, you don't need to further sharpen your life skills. You need to do it. Do it as a teamwork along with the youngsters in your family. Now what happened is we have had this lockdown business. Things have become worse in terms of life skills. On the one side, we have this debate going on when and if schools should reopen, when and if children will actually be able to go to school, and at least the life skills that they were learning there from the time they get into the bus and he wants to occupy a seat and one elder fellow comes and says, hey, move out, man, that's my seat, I'm going to sit here. Or if this fellow has not had a proper breakfast, he opens his tiffin box and somebody snatches that thing which is there in his tiffin and eats it off. He has to learn how to handle all those things. When he walks into this thing, he's got maybe the non-teaching staff, some security man or some sweeper, somebody saying hello to him, somebody doing something. He identifies his friends who are there and then, they laugh and joke. By the time the school starts, the bell rings and they have to suddenly learn that, okay, stop all your shouting noises. You have to stand quietly over here. You'll get punished if you talk or if you say anything. So we have to learn all those disciplines. Like that, the whole day went off like that. In between, there was that, very, very interesting PT or physical education period. And the kids would be waiting desperately just to get out of the four walls of the school and go and run around and do something and come back. At least we had that till March. Now we have been deprived of it. Initially, we thought it's okay. Thankfully, it has come at a time when, the academic year had almost come to an end. So it's okay, instead of holidays and summer vacation, children will be locked up at home for some time and then everything will be all right. But as you know, it doesn't look like it is happening. We don't know when it will be lifted. We do not know when schools will reopen and children will go back to this lifestyle of schooling, running around, shouting, tumbling over each other, getting scolded by teachers, crying, laughing. We don't know when that is going to happen. Okay. If the child is not going to school, earlier when there were vacations or a child was not in school for whatever the reason, he would play around with neighbors, he would go and spend time in grandparents' house or in uncle and auntie's house. There were so many other things. He would go around in his colony, laughing, joking, playing with other children. He would go for some sports or some other coaching classes or something of that sort. Now even that has been deprived. There are many parents who are not willing to send their children out at all, even for activities which have officially been permitted by the government, but the fear is there. At the same time, there's a lot of debate going on, when and if schools should reopen. And if schools are not reopening, how do we continue with the education? So they came out with this online education. Now, online education means screen sitting in front of maximum a 17 inch or in many cases only 6 inches of screen. Now this whole world, the life of a child, including of course a lot of adults also, has now been restricted to 17 inches or 6 inches or whatever it is. Life cannot proceed that way. So on the one side, we have to abide by government regulations, whatever the experts are saying, whatever the schools are saying. Online classes, 30 minutes, 60 minutes, one period per day, one period per week, or let that go on. I am not going to comment on that. But what I am very, very particular about, and I'd like to put it to you people as a very strong point, whatever else you do, there are parents who are saying, okay, in the worst case, my son or my daughter will lose 1 year. So what? He is only 5 years old or 10 years old. It's okay. 1 year later, he will complete. Instead of completing his 10th standard at 15 years, he'll complete at 16 years. What's so great about it? No, it's not as simple as that. It's not that whether he's completing it 15 or 16 years. It is this current situation which is depriving most of us, particularly children, but even including adults, of certain life skills. Now, what happened when this lockdown came? People took it as a sort of adventure, as a holiday. Okay, we are locked up. So what? What are we going to do? Come on, let's, you know, subscribe for Amazon Prime. Whole family will sit together. We'll get some snacks and this and that. And we'll sit and watch a nice comedy movie and we'll enjoy ourselves. Or we'll play board games or something of that sort. Or come on, everybody get into the kitchen and help mama. You know, that domestic help cannot come. The cook cannot come. So mama has to do everything. Come on, we'll all pitch in. Ah, life's adventure. Come on, you wash the plate. You cut the vegetables. You do something. Everything looked very fine. Then there were these nice and proud mamas, you know, who would show their 3-year-old or 4-year-old dancing away to some, you know, item number song and all that, videographing and circulating it to all the friends. See my little one, how well she is dancing, or something of that sort. It was good while it lasted. But for how long? Can you visualize this going on and on and on and on for months? We don't know when this is going to come to an end. And what will be the impact of all this on families, individuals, close relationships, and children? That is where I want us to reflect on in today's interaction. We need to enhance our life skills much more now than it was before. I don't need to repeat it. I'm sure by now most of you know it. The 10 life skills include things like critical thinking on one side, creative thinking on the other side. Communication skills, interpersonal relationships. Self-awareness, management of my emotions. Empathy, understanding others, and social skills. Management of stress, management of all other emotions. All these is in simple words what life skills is all about. Just take that WHO list and go through those 10 life skills. Can you deny that each one of them is absolutely essential for the well-being, for the good growth, and for the future of every individual? More so children, but including adults. So what my recommendation is, whatever the government stipulates, whatever the school says, whatever rules, regulations, you want to, you know, abide by it, you don't want to abide by it, I leave it to you as parents, adults, teachers, whatever role that you are playing. But what I want you to please supplement it. We have 24 hours. Most families are spending all 24 hours together. Work from home, so daddy, mommy goes into one corner, puts on the laptop and works. But okay, fine. There also, there are gaps. You can take off. There is an end to it. You may be working 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours a day. You still have the balance 12 hours left. And children, they have a lot of time. Even the latest guidelines which have been given about online classes start from something like 30 minutes per week for the tiny tots, going on to 30 minutes per day for the little elder children, going on to twice a week, going on to 4 times a week or whatever it is. Now, what are children going to be doing for the rest of the time, and how do they take? The one thing that I want to tell you is that whatever activities that you can think of to do as a family or with your children, or even if you are busy, if you can tell your children to do this or whatever activities you can, I want you to please ensure that those activities are not connected to any screen, neither the TV, nor the laptop, or the tablet, or the mobile phone. Because I want everyone to see the world beyond the screen, Today I was reading a very interesting write-up about an army colonel who participated in the, you know, what do you call that, cycling race, which involves a lot of hurdles and cross-country and this and that in America. It's supposed to be a very great event where people move from one end of America to the other end of the country on a cycle. They go up and down the hill, they go through snow, they go through slush and this and that. So it's a great event. This Indian man, I'm very proud of it, won the third prize in that. But you know something interesting? He didn't step out of his house. His cycle was that exercise cycle that we see. So he was sitting on that cycle, and that cycle is connected by the computer to the internet to something. So they make it more and more difficult. So he has to put in, like, he's going uphill, so it becomes, the cycling becomes more difficult. So he has to gasp and pant and something of that sort. And then it becomes slippery or something of that sort. I really don't understand. But he won a virtual endurance race. Now, if that is going to be the future, I really pity what's going to happen to the younger generation. And I'm hearing a very unusual term, which people seem to be talking so naturally and so easily. They are talking about this term called new normal. So they say education through online is going to be the new normal. Being locked up is going to be the new normal. Virtual cycling and racing and all that is going to be the new normal. Telemedicine, without seeing the doctor, without going to the doctor, getting the medicine prescribed and treatment is going to go on. It is the new normal. See, when I am forced to do something which goes against the basic nature of human beings, I have to do it. It is due to maybe government regulations or safety or whatever it is. I have to do it. I will do it. But the moment I give a label called new normal to it, what am I doing? I am defeating. I am giving up. I am surrendering. I am saying this is what life is going to be. Please, no. If I fall sick and doctor says, don't get out of the bed, lie down flat for the next 1 week. You should not get up. You should not exert yourself. You should not eat more than whatever these, that. All the regulations he gives me, I follow that because I want to get well. But I look forward to the day when I am going to get up from the bed and I'm going to be independent. I don't lie on the bed and say, this is the new normal. What will happen if I do that? So please, ladies and gentlemen, whatever we are going through right now, whatever you're being forced to do, do it as per the regulations, as per guidelines, as per your own, security that you want to play safe. But please don't call it the new normal. It is the new abnormal. We should go back to the old normal. That is what life is all about. Okay. Now, coming to what is this? When I say life skills and you should do it at home, all that, what are we really talking about? Let's start with something very simple. You have a small child at home. You want to change his clothes. You want him to, have a bath and wear fresh clothes. Instead of going to the cupboard and pulling out, the most appropriate t-shirt and handing it over to him and saying that, after the bath, put on this clean shirt. You open the cupboard and tell him, which shirt do you want to wear? There's this blue one, and there's this dark blue one, and there's this green one, and there's this half sleeves and short sleeves and full sleeves. Which one do you want to wear? Let him select. If he doesn't, then your antenna should go up. There is something missing in the child. He is not able to take a decision. If he turns to you and say, no, Amma, no, Appa, you please select for me, the child is missing out on something very vital. Okay, now the child selects. Ask him, why did you select that? Or if he's selecting something which is not appropriate, the weather is a little hot, and he selects a full sleeve shirt instead of a half sleeve shirt. Explain to him, you want to wear this? It looks attractive. You said you like this color, that's why you're wearing it. But are you aware that you'll sweat a little more, full sleeves will be a little uncomfortable, when the heat gets on in the afternoon? So do you know that if you select a half sleeve one, then it will be a little more comfortable and things of that sort. You know that sometimes the current goes off and the fan may not work, in which case will you be able to be comfortable? Ladies and gentlemen, that's all life skills is all about. It may look so ridiculously simple to you that you may say, what's so great about it? We can do it every day. We can do, we are doing whatever it is. But no, please give it significance. This is where the portion of life has to be completed. Let's take relationships, for example. You can do a very simple and a very lively, life skills exercise or activity. Inevitably, let's say you have a child who keeps complaining that you are very strict. You shout at me and you don't allow me to do that. I want to watch Cartoon Network, but you are forcing me to study. Whatever it is, there is this argument going on. And the child is also unhappy saying that, why do you always shout at me? Why do you do this? Why do you do that? You don't tell my sister. Why do you always tell me? Or something of that sort. Start a simple activity. Reverse the roles. Say, you be mama and I be you. Now you tell me what you would like to tell if you were in my shoes. Let the child say. Sometimes he may even exaggerate. Sometimes he may even say things which you don't. Don't stop him or her. Make a mental note or even keep a piece of paper and jot down. Let's say that, taking the role of the parent, the child says, you are very stupid. Now you are conscious of the fact that you don't call him stupid. Don't interrupt. Keep quiet. Let him finish what he says. Have that discussion. And then say, hey man, I noticed one thing that you told me that I am stupid. Do I really use that word? Do I call you stupid at any time? Yeah, I remember that time, that when that term exam was there. Oh yeah, I think once I did. I'm not very sure. I don't recollect. But I think that's not a word to be used. I don't think that should be done. Okay, what happens when I call you stupid? How do you feel? Teach the child feeling, self-awareness, management of emotions. How do you feel? In fact, I strongly recommend print out an emoticons chart showing at least 20, 30 different emotions in those little emoticons, right? And with the name of that emotion written below. Irritated, angry, furious. So when this child gets angry or he starts raising his voice, ask him, are you irritated? Are you angry? Or are you furious? Teach the child to identify and label his feelings. Simple things like that. Okay, coming back to this role play. We have now identified that there are certain words which hurt. Ask. Okay, I use these words, is it? I called you stupid, or I said you are dumb, or I said this, or I said you will never learn, or something. I've done that. No? Okay. How do you feel, firstly? Explain why those feelings come, how you feel, what happens, all those type of things. And then perhaps make another chart. These are the words which will never be used in our home. Anybody, father, mother, tata, ajji, son, daughter, nobody will use this word idiot or stupid to anyone else. Including, of course, sometimes very loosely we start using S, asterisk, asterisk, T. We are not going to use that word also. Put it up. And then say, what should be the punishment if anybody uses this? Teach the child the ability to be able to decide and write down what the punishment should be. First time punishment, second time punishment. That's how even the law goes, no? You break a traffic rule, first time they'll fine you 100 rupees, second time 500 rupees, third time they'll suspend your license or seize your vehicle or something of the sort. Same thing should happen over here. And once you do any, I just gave as an example, when you do any of such exercise, at the end of it, or maybe later, let it pass on, get busy, do something else, studies, food and everything goes on, finishes off. Then say, yesterday when we were sitting and doing this particular exercise, what did we learn? Which life skill have we learned? If you say it is decision making with regard to which t-shirt, or you say it is handling difficult, handling stress, you know, what do you do when somebody is arguing with you? Or it is creative thinking, where I have to come out with new ideas. Okay, this is what you have learned. Now, can we do something? Can you give me ideas of some more exercises that we can do in this particular area of life skills? Give time to the child. 1 day, 2 days. Go on with other activities. If the child comes out with something, give him a lot of positive strokes. Praise him and say, hey, wonderful, you've done a good job of it. If he doesn't, then point it out. Don't scold him, but say that, hey, I would have been happy if you come out. Anyway, now I'll take you forward by something. We keep doing that on a regular basis, and there's a lot of things to benefit from it. In fact, I requested Purnima, our director, to just share with you quickly one or two of these type of activities or things that we do with children. We used to have till last year wonderful summer camps on life skills for children and all that. Anyway, we continue wherever we get an opportunity, we do it. But just to give you an idea, to drive home the point of how these things are done, she'll just quickly share one or two with you. Then I will now move on to giving you a few life skills and having an open house and a discussion with you as to how we should take this thing forward of teaching life skills at home, not only for children, but even for adults. So let's hear out what Purnima has to say about a few case studies here and there.
At Panjara, we for more than a decade, we have been conducting life skills development camps for children. We call it for the youngs and blossoms. So blossoms is for children who are say till the age of 8 or 9 years old. And many times we also have children, the little ones who are 3 and a half, 4 years old, and the parents say that, no, why don't you just take them along with you. It is so amazing that parents come and ask us that, ma'am, do you think she will understand what is angry and what is sad? And we do very small, simple activities which, help us to understand that. If you ask them, hey, what makes you angry? Or what happens if somebody, snatches your chocolate? And then she would end up telling that, I get angry, I get irritated. So we ask her that, so what do you do at such times? She says, I go to my room, close the door, and this is a 4-year-old girl, okay? And she's such a darling, such a sweetheart. She says, I go to my room, I put my face on the pillow and cry. I said, pillow, is there any particular reason? She's saying, so that my, crying sound doesn't go out. Otherwise, I know my mother will again scold me. So if a 4-year-old child can emote herself so well, I think it is an indicator for us that we can do tremendous things with children. In fact, at this point, what I also want to share with you is that when we do these life skills, we came up with a nice idea. So while there were many parents who would be waiting for these children, to take them home, it would be for 2 hours every day. So we had our volunteers who gave free services and would do life skills for the parents. So while communication for the children was happening in one room, communication for the parents was happening in the other room. And there was this boy who once came, and he apparently felt very low about himself, and he would just not think that he is good at for anything at all. So as a team, we just took it up as a task and we worked on it. I'll just share with you about what happened with that boy, while I just go back to the point that it was amazing to see that there were so many children who had fantastic creativity, interpersonal communication to get their tasks done. And the relationships were so good. And they would know that if a critical situation comes up, how I, immediately handle it and manage it. Whereas there would be some parents who, while sharing something, would just break down, and they say, I really don't know what to do. So which means going to say that life skills is an integral part for parents as much as for children. So this boy who came to us, we have a 2 weeks camp. So this boy who came to us, he would just not think good about himself at all. So as a team, we had a set of around 4 or 5 volunteers. We ended up just ensuring that we ask him to pinpoint every small thing which he is good at. It could just be that I cut my nails regularly, or it could just be that I ensure that every Sunday I'm oiling my hair, or if anybody comes home, I immediately, you know, open the fan switch and ask them for a glass of water, or I help my friends to complete their homework and I sit back with them. It could be the smallest of tasks, which could also be I'm not fussy about food and I ensure I don't waste food. I ensure that I help my mother to clear up the tables. I wash my own plates and spoons. It could be something as simple as that. But when that got pointed out for that boy, it created such a magic for him that he felt that yes, here there are someone, these people who are so much not judging me and who are ensuring that, you know, they are finding out what are the smallest but yet simplest and nice thing which I am very strong at. You know what, ladies and gentlemen, at the end of the 2 weeks, he told, you know what, you are giving me one certificate, but then I am taking two of it with me. Because one was the old one and one is my new one. So both of us are getting these certificates today. So what did we do? Did we do any magic which you as a parent could not do for the last 15 years? No, absolutely nothing. Because you know your child very well. You know your ward very well inside out. So what happened in those 10 days, in those 2 weeks? It's just that we all made a very nice attempt to ensure that that boy was taken in totally with full acceptance and without judging him for anything at all. And that is the magic that we can see by ensuring that we impart the right life skills to children. And moving on, we will be taking your questions and continuing our topic on teaching life skills, teach life skills at home.
Hi everyone. So like Purni was saying, you know, here we are talking about life skills, one of the most important skills that everybody should have. So we in Banjara are conducting a program on life skills. It's called CLS, Certificate in Life Skills, right? So we are looking at starting on 7th of March, and we are going to be using an online mode this time. So we are, about to finalize the plans. By next week, our prospectus should be up. So any of you who is interested in life skills, learning life skills at home. So what we are looking at doing is to send you, it will be about a 16 session program. That's what we are looking at. And we will be sending you, different life skills. It will be online. We'll also be having review classes and doubt clearing sessions. So those are the things that we are planning starting 7th of March, and it will go on till 20th of June. So if you're interested, please call up our office and we will help you. We are also looking at, doing a classroom session on the training part, the presentations, if you want to, develop or hone your presentation skills. That is something we are planning again in a month or so, maybe by April, we are looking at starting that also here in our training house. So every Sunday, for 12 sessions, we'll be, planning that particular program also. So if you want to, learn life skills, impart it in your day-to-day life to others, to your children, and eventually if you want to become a trainer, so all these things is what we are looking at, in the upcoming months. So March 7th is when we are starting CLS. For further information, please contact us. So now I hand it over to Dr. Ali.
Thank you, Seema. So as I was telling you, this year, this 2020, has
not only stopped the physical education of children in classrooms and things like that, it has also sort of confined the children in areas of social, emotional, expressing of emotion, so many things like that. And that is only as far as children are concerned. The same thing applies to the adults. So the one area which I have been emphasizing on, and I will continue to emphasize till things really get back to some semblance of okay, is that we have to pick up, put it in, fast forward mode as far as development of life skills is concerned, not only of children, but of our own self also. So anyway, after whatever I've told you, whatever thoughts have come in your mind, please feel free. Where is the chat box?
Sorry, that's the chat box.
This is the chat box. So there's nothing in the chat box except good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning.
So far,
okay.
Yes.
So any comments, doubts, questions, whatever you feel like part of developing life skills is to have a curious mind and to ask questions and to agree, disagree, whatever it is. So please, come out with whatever you have to say. There's always this starting trouble I have seen in any session that I do. The first person to put in is always holding back. And then when 1, 2, 3 people put up their questions, then suddenly, you have a barrage of questions, and then we have to say, no, time up. We are winding up the session. So I hope you have agreed with what I told you, which is that there is a strong need to give a little boost to the development of life skills of everybody concerned. Since our focus inevitably is on, the younger generation and children and all that, so we speak more about them. I think we equally need to keep sharpening. Many of us who have not stepped out, for example, now it has been 8, 9, 10 months, I know of people who have not even stepped out of their houses. And there again, whatever you have lost out in terms of things like, social interaction, emotional expressions and empathy and whatever you may want to call it. There's so many things which need to be, always looked into. And single mother, stay along with my parents. I try a lot to make my 5-year-old daughter learn basic skills, but the grandparents tend to pamper her a lot and it affects her. At the first level, I would suggest that please have a talk to your parents, not as a confrontation and not as a question mark or why are you doing this or this is wrong or something. What do you feel, Amma, Appa? What do you feel about upbringing of this child and things of that sort? What are the do's and don'ts? How do you want to go about it? Whatever good things they say, praise them and say, oh, I can learn so much from you. You're so nice of you and all that. Wherever they are saying things which are a little outdated, generally with the thing which grandparents say is, we have done this for you people and didn't it work out successfully? Yes, that is true. Grandfather may have gone to school in a bullock cart. We are not going to send our child in a bullock cart to school. No, we have to move at times. And more so if it's a single child, if it's a single parent, those sort of things, the needs of the child is different. Try to bring all that. In the worst case, that they are very adamant and they're not open to change and they are going on pampering the child, get your child, aside once in a while when they are not around. And without criticizing them, just, reaffirm to your child that I am your mother. I am the final authority as far as your actions and behavior are concerned. So I will not argue with, my mommy, daddy, because I respect them and I love them. But there are certain things which even if they are lax in the discipline and all that, I'm going to reinforce it to you and you have to listen to me. And get that into what we call as the carrot and stick method, where whatever nice thing she does, give her a lot of appreciation. But the moment she refuses to listen or takes the refuge of going to grandparents and getting pampered by them and all that, you use the stick, not literally the stick, but productive means of disciplining her. Children are generally becoming dull at home. They seem to be tired of online classes. Yes. One is, of course, hopefully now, finally, we will have, you know, schools have slowly started reopening. So I am anticipating in the next 1, 2, 3, 4 months, things will get back to normalcy. So at least that the worst period is over. But like I have been telling you, we need to, you know, supplement whatever they have lost out by all these various means. If you want, you can just pick up, made this, you know, Growing with Life Skills, a handbook for various types of activities which children can do, which help in developing of the life skills. So many such things are available to you, depending on the child, depending on the logistics and so many other things. Someone says, how does time out work for children and disciplining them? Yes, why not? It can work. Try it out. See, children are very unique. No, with one child it works, with one child it doesn't. But in general, a policy of time out can be pretty good. Try it out and see. Only thing that I say when it comes to the disciplining or punishment or whatever it is, don't be too harsh. Step it up slowly. You start off with a very small timeout and then keep increasing if the child seems to be not coming around or not behaving the way you want. Vinita says, sometimes I feel that however much we teach or learn about life skills, especially to children, but by instead of saying if we practice or certain things, no doubt about it, Vinita, 100% I agree with you. Children are very poor at listening to their elders, but they're very good at mimicking them. What you do plays a very, very strong impact. So even when we are talking about, that's why we, you know, titled this, that life skills for all. We all need to do it. And if we decide to get into the mode of improving our life skills, children will mimic us and they will follow us. So Rika says, any example on critical thinking that we can apply in daily life? Yes, start questioning anything and everything. Why is this happening? I want some logical answers to it. Sometimes you will get very good. So you say, yes, when I questioned this, then I came to know this answer. When even if you don't get, your habit of developing your critical thinking keeps going up. It could be something as simple as you walk into your neighbor's house and you see a particular way in which they have kept their furniture. Question yourself. You don't even have to get into a discussion with your neighbor, but say that, wouldn't it have been better if they had kept this chair this side or this table this side? Anything and everything, start, you know, questioning. That is the crux of developing or sharpening your critical thinking. I understand that it's never too late in learning life skills. Absolutely, I agree with you. But how do we make the child understand that life skills are important, especially in cases where other family members felt it is not important? What you can do in such a situation is, don't use the word life skills. Take up real life issues. A child comes to you and says that, there's this bully who is treating me like this. Or a child comes and says that my friends are like that. Or a child comes and says, daddy is too strict, he's not listening to me. So there you bring it up and say, rather than me helping you or spoon feeding you, can I teach you how to handle this situation? Once you have worked on 1, 2, 3, 4 of these type of situations, then you slowly bring in and say, remember last week we had spoken about that, 2 weeks back we had discussed this and this and that. You know what we have been doing? We have been practicing and sharpening life skills. So can we now take it up further? Can we now make a list of what are the things to be made? Slowly induct the child into that. In a period of crisis, many parents won't allow to express. Is it absolutely correct? No, not at all. I want communication is the first pillar of a good family interaction and a family well-being. Everything should be open. Only thing is, see to it that children are not scared. Let's say daddy's lost his job or there's a threat to his job. It should be told. It should not be hidden from the children, but in a very reassuring manner that in the worst case, if this happened, I still know how to earn a livelihood. We still have enough savings or whatever it is to get along. So nothing serious will happen. But since this is there, you may find me a little thoughtful or even irritable and all that. I'm going through this little bit of a crisis. I can manage it, but I'm being open with you. Let's all understand and support each other and those sort of things. Okay, how do we tell a grown-up adult daughter how to dress up appropriately for the occasion? But firstly, the question is appropriately. See, this is a typical generation gap. No, it's nothing new. It has always been there for ages and ages. There was one generation of mine where if my sisters would not wear a dupatta even at home, you know, the grandmother would keep screaming at her and saying that what a horrible girl she is and things like that. So all that happens. But basically what it boils down to is some sort of compromise, some sort of give and take, some sort of understanding, and do not connect up so-called inappropriate dressing with the morals or principles of the child. That is their way of life. That is how they feel in this current generation. That's what their peers are doing. Therefore, they are doing this. Try and get them around rather than having a confrontation. When guests come home, my son takes advantage and does all that we tell him not to do because he knows we won't scold him. Why should we not scold him in front of others? I very strongly believe that the same principle should apply whoever is there. Do not allow your child to take advantage. Even tell your guess, excuse me, I'll just take 2-3 minutes because my son is now doing this. I need to, you know, correct him. And in their presence, you can scold the child. Let him learn that he cannot sort of emotionally blackmail you or anything of that sort. How to implement time out, Usha, varies from person to person, as I told you. It could be a simple thing like you must have seen those cartoons of Dennis the Menace and all that. You put one chair in the corner facing the wall and you say you're going to sit here for the next 5 minutes. Let there be perhaps a clock there or an alarm or something saying that till this alarm rings, you're not going to get up from there. Or timeout can be for particular activities that you used to watch, this particular program or something of that sort. For one day today, you will not be allowed to watch that program. From tomorrow onwards, you can continue with that. Infants are very smart and intelligent, and picking up from what they see, they say that their grasping starts deteriorating as they grow old. But it doesn't deteriorate, it slows down. How do we ensure that they're always smart and intelligent and fast learners? Always, yes. The more you keep stimulating from infant age, stimulate all the 5 senses. That is what a child wants. And then move more and more towards communication. That is how it should be. Let the line, and as long as you stimulate the curiosity of the infant, which is already there, you just have to, you know, fulfill it as much as possible. If a very small child, when he's growing up, is told, no, don't ask silly questions, don't do this, don't do that, and don't ask these sort of questions, keep quiet, you're asking too many questions, that is what deteriorates, as you said, you know, their capacity of learning and things of that sort.
Ali, I'm noticing that everybody's talking about children and teenagers when it comes to life skills.
Yeah.
So is life skills also for, you know, adults?
100%. That's exactly what I said. No, that let us learn and let us become role models. Children will learn by themselves. Task becomes so much more easier. You don't have to keep running behind the child. And don't you want your life, quality of your life to improve? Whether you are 30 or 60 or 90, it doesn't matter. As long as there is life, you need to learn life skills and you need to constantly keep enriching your life. Kumar says, as a life skills trainer, certain times I feel teaching children is more effective than compared to teenagers. Yes, that's a fact. Anything, no? The earlier you learn, the faster it is. When you're a small child and you learn cycling, it remains with you for the rest of your life. If at 40 years of age, you want to first time ride on a cycle, it becomes that much more difficult. I'm not saying it is impossible, but as age advances, a lot of things become a little more difficult than what they were earlier. That is what we need to keep in mind. And that also is the reason why it has to be done. What is discipline according to you? Discipline is conforming to certain norms and certain regulations so that we live in harmony. So when we live in a family, there has to be certain rules and regulations. We live in society, there's a neighborhood or there is a building and all that, we have to follow certain rules. There are certain rules laid down by the government when you are going in the vehicle or you're walking on the road or something. So discipline is conforming to certain accepted and enforced parameters. But when it comes down to family discipline, always ask yourself, am I doing it just to pressurize the child or do I actually believe that this is true or is there something wrong? Always differentiate between activities or, you know, behavior which is totally unacceptable and activities and behavior which are not recommended, which are, you know, not very healthy. In the second category, you can be liberal. In the first category, once you are liberal in the second category, in the first category, you can be very affirmative and very assertive. The child will listen. There's a friend of mine who's very intelligent and a balanced person. People around her feel proud to be associated with her, except she faces sibling jealousy due to her success. She seems depressed. Now, any suggestions to boost? I know this should have been dealt with in childhood. If this is a grown-up person and the sibling rivalry has still continued, if she is really genuinely concerned, she can start building bridges with her sibling, start praising her for small things. Even if this particular person is very good in certain areas, obviously the sibling also has some good qualities. Tell her to start identifying those good qualities. And most important, repeating that in front of others. So in front of third persons, if this so-called intelligent and achiever sister can tell people about how I am very proud that my sister is good in this. I am very thankful to her that she makes these gestures. I feel proud to be her sister. Slowly it will come down. It will take time if they're already grown up because it's deep-rooted, but it can be set right to whatever extent we should work on it. CLS training for adults or children? I'm confused since discussion is more on children. CLS training is primarily to develop your life skills, to understand firstly what are life skills, what is the significance of each of them, why they need to be built up, and how they need to be built up. After that, it is up to you whether you want to use it for yourself, you want to use it for your own child, you want to train other children or adults in doing that. So what we are doing is to emphasize that you are very clear and you have a good in-depth understanding of the life skills. These sessions will cover every aspect of life skill, and they will give you practical inputs on how to build up and sharpen those things. Harmi has asked a very nice question about procrastination. In fact, I've done one of our the Saturday talks on procrastination, and I have a booklet also if you want. It is something which affects us many a time. I would not like to take too much of time because there are other questions waiting. But yes, Harmi, you can, you know, take the tips and you know, methodologies from the booklet which I have written. In that, I've given a lot of exercises and, you know, tips and techniques. If you follow that, I think you should be able to overcome to whatever extent possible. Which of the skill do you think is most important among life skills? No, you can't specify like that. It's like asking a parent that if you have got, you know, five children, which is your best child or something of that sort. It doesn't work that way. It is a comprehensive thing. You have to look at it from a very holistic point of view. Then only you will understand that, you know, the whole area aspect of life should be very balanced. Every aspect of your life should be equally important. For example, when we talk about critical thinking or creative thinking, which is more important? I had these two wonderful young students who one day when individually we had told them, one will give a presentation on critical thinking and the other one will give on creative thinking. When I called out the first person's name, both of them came on the stage. I said, hey, wait, first this one has to do, then that. No, sir, we are going to do together. I said, why are we going to do together? They said, because we are going to give a presentation on critical thinking, combination of creativity and critical thinking. And they supplemented each other so beautifully. Those are the type of things that I want you to take into account. Life skills is not like completing a portion or learning something theory or something of that sort. It's very, very challenging and very exciting and thrilling also. Can adults change by learning and training in life skills? Yes, they can. That's the beauty of it. What we require of you is the intention and the persistence. All other things, we can tell you how to go about it. If you get stuck, you get back to us and we'll correct it. We'll try out different methods of doing. There are so many ways in which we can, you know, work on that thing. But as I said, whether you are 30 or 60 or 90, you can still improve your quality of life by bringing in this life skills improvement for yourself. And if you focus on yourself and you do it, automatically you get affected. If you're working in an office, then your colleagues and your office, the staff get affected and they improve. If you're in a family, then the youngsters and the children, they help to improve. Booklet is available online. Please check with the office, the method and this and that, how you can ask for it. They will take care of it. You can get in touch with Banjara office. Anything of this sort, please get in touch. They will guide you. They will tell you what are the things, whether it is free counseling, whether it is courses, whether it is booklets, anything of that sort. Please feel free to get in touch. From time to time, whenever you have a requirement, they will tell you how to go about the things. No, Shweta, our booklets, unfortunately, so far are not available in Hindi. We have brought out a couple of books in Kannada, and we have made that beginning. We are open to the idea if somebody is really good in Hindi translation who can get the gist of the thing. See, we don't need a literary translator. There are many like that. But life skills, emotions, these things require that human touch. And that is why it is very difficult. When we translated our book on emotional intelligence, half a dozen people tried and we were just not satisfied. Finally, we got one of our DC students who is very good, who really understands in depth what counseling is, what human behavior is. When she did the translation and she was supervised by another very elderly student of ours, who was very good at this thing. And between them, they did a wonderful job. And now we have this booklet in Kannada on emotional intelligence. We have a small one called 30 Days to a Better Life. 30 different exercises, practice them one per day. And in a month, you will start seeing some change in your quality of life. So this small book is also available both in English as well as in Kannada. And if there is somebody who's really good in translation and in Hindi, we would invite you to come and join us and see whether we can translate into Hindi and bring it out. I thought only young people can learn. No, that is absolutely wrong. And yes, I think young people only can learn. You're right, absolutely. Only young people can learn. Young people up to 99 years of age. If you have crossed 100, then we'll have to think whether your learning has gone down or not. But till you are 99, you can be very young and you can learn a lot of things. So Ali, good. I saw that
there's Ali, been a I was lot telling of, them about the Sunday presentation skill development also.
Yeah.
Can you also just...
those who want to become speakers, presenters, trainers and this and that, we keep doing that. And obviously that has to be done face to face. We can't do it as an online program. Last year, we tried it out also. We felt we are not being very effective. So this program is what we are starting very soon. However busy you are, if you can just take a couple of hours off on Sundays, we will do it in a very practical manner. There is no theory. There is nothing to learn, mug up. There are no textbooks. But practically speaking, how you can improve what we call as the communication and presentation skills, whether you do it as a professional teacher, trainer, mentor, whether you do it individually in your own right, but it always helps because I keep reminding you that communication is the first pillar of good close relationships. You can improve your communication not only at an individual one-to-one. Many of us are very good at one-to-one communication, but when we have to talk to a group of people or to a crowd or something, we get very scared and we start become reticent. But I can assure you that you can overcome that this thing. We have seen wonders of people, how they get transformed and how they become confident, and again their whole lifestyle changes, their self-esteem goes up when they can stand in front of a big group of people and talk confidently to them and things like that. So that's our contribution to try and see how best we can help you into improving your quality of life. Yes, Nazneen, you have a lot of years and years to go. You are definitely very, very young. So I'll see you when you touch 100. And that's the time we'll discuss whether you have become too old to learn or not. And if I'm not around, I'll come down only to discuss that with you and then go back quickly and report wherever I'm supposed to be. But life is wonderful. Let's all celebrate life in whatever different ways we can. Please keep in touch. Please keep improving your life and the life of people around you. Have a wonderful day and have a lovely weekend. Thank you very much.